Hello everyone and welcome back to another video. I hope you are learning from this video series. So people are asking me why this all the videos in this series are long. So the reason behind it is like I want this series to be kind of a lecture videos because in lectures I don't just teach you the topics which I am supposed to teach, but I also discuss a few more things which will help you in your career in the tech field. For example, if in future videos I'm also going to talk about Git and how to upload projects on GitHub and all stuff. So these things are not in the title or description maybe of the videos, but these things are covered in lectures. So assume these videos as lectures. That's why these are long, but you will going to learn a lot from this series. Okay, so let's continue with our Dart programming series. So probably this is the last video in Dart programming. After that we will move to Flutter app development directly. So in that case, Flutter app development, so currently we are just working on the command line and stuff. We have not developed any app, so there is no app, your own app on your Android phone till now. But from the next video, most probably we will be starting with app Flutter app development. So moreover, this Dart series or this 2-3 videos which I have created are basically help you while you are writing code in Flutter, since Dart is like the programming language which most of the people are not familiar, and it's going crazy because of the Flutter only. So okay, so let's continue with the series. Okay, so I think we have done the for loops and we have completed the enumeration and we have completed the functions. So I hope you understand all the topics. If you have any doubt, then you can ask me in the comment section or any other means you like to have. Okay, so now we're going to talk about asynchronous programming. So till now, what all the code we are writing is basically synchronous code or synchronized code. So what's the difference between asynchronous and synchronous, and why we use asynchronous programming? So asynchronous is just the opposite of what we are doing till now. As you know, like most of the programming languages, like JavaScript is a single threaded programming language. Similarly, Dart is also single thread programming language. Like the compiler, or when the program gets executed, so it will follow a single thread of processing. You can just imagine in this way. So it will follow a simple track of executing the code. Okay, so that's why we can call it as single thread programming language. So when you call any asynchronous operation, then the program will continue to execute and will not wait for that particular code block which you have said that, like, this is the asynchronous code. So it will not wait for that to be first executed, then move to the next statement. It will just move to the next statement, and later on when the processing or the asynchronous operation has completed, it will execute the corresponding callback or something code you have written for it. Okay, this is how asynchronous programming works. Okay, so basically in real world examples, like when we are going to have our Flutter series, you will have a better idea because we are going to use this asynchronous programming a lot. So in real world example, you can understand this thing as like getting data from the internet. So you don't know how much time it could take to get the data from internet. Yes, there is a timeout thing, but you exactly don't know what like how much time it would take to like get the data from internet. So this for this we need to create an asynchronous thread. We cannot do it in our main thread, because for example, if I talk about in Flutter case, so when you are developing apps and you are using this getting data from internet in your main thread, then your app will stuck and the app freezes. So you can the user will face issues like he says your app freezes and I cannot use it. And after some time, if the data has still not arrived to the app, then the Android kernel can stop the app from running, and it would say the app has stopped responding and something like that. So that's why we take all the like stuff from which we need to get the data from internet and all, so we take them to the asynchronous programming side and the asynchronous threads. Okay, so performing long running task or time taking tasks. For example, if there are some tasks which are like a bit which should take more time than expected, then we use this asynchronous things. And most of the database operations are kind of asynchronous, like for example, if you are using MongoDB and other databases, So for that we need to, like, it may take a few moments to add or create entry in the database. So that's why this can be asynchronous also. So now there are three basically more like there are three keywords which from which we define the asynchronous thing. Okay, so the first is async. So what async is, it is used to represent a function. Like this function is an asynchronous function. Okay, so the compiler or while executing, it will not wait for that function to complete first, then go to the next statement. It will directly go to the next statement, and this async function will be executed in a separate thread. Okay, so the second is await keyword. So what await is? Await is used to represent the exact statement which will take a longer time. For example, in the complete function, so I'm getting data from the internet in a particular statement, like this statement gets the data from the internet. But the statements after getting the data, I need to execute a bit code which is related to that data. Like I want to process that data, I want to convert the data to object from JSON. So that stuff will be completed after the execution or after the completion of this await statement, which is getting data from internet. So that for that statement getting data from internet, we will use the await keyword. So now talking about future. So like if you have experience with JavaScript, then in JavaScript the future is quite similar to the promises in JavaScript. So what future is, like in future, it just represents like some data. Or with like when we declare future, then we enter a data type. Like this data type we can expect. So we say it will store this data type value in near future. Okay, so this is what future is. Okay, so from the example you will get like a good idea about future. But while we are developing the apps in the next few videos in Flutter series, so you will have a better idea about it. So there's a side note here. Like when I say long-running task, it usually means something which might take more time as compared to the execution time of a normal statement. Like for example, you can take a rough idea of 2 seconds to 2 minutes. Like if it just takes 2 seconds only, but then also we need to make it an asynchronous task. Like we don't know how much exact time it would take. Okay, so here's an example you can see. So what this example is like, where first of all, when you are like reading someone else code, you should try to find out the initial point, or you should be the compiler yourself. So how I would think, I would just find in the code where is the main method, because the compiler will start from there. So I have found the main method is right here. So how the compiler will run? So it should, what should be the output of this program? I will say like I'm in the main method. It says print fetching user order. So it will print this thing first, then it will say print, then create order message. Okay, so this is a method, this is the function which is called in print. So this function should return something. Okay, so we will go to create order message. So here's the create order message, and it returns a string. Okay, here's the return type. Now what it does, it creates a new variable var order is equals to fetch user order. So it's again a different method. Okay, so we will go to this method. Okay, so this method returns future and then the data type string. What it means, like it will return a string in near future. Okay, so this is an asynchronous thing. Okay, so this statement means is like we say future, then we will in the angular brackets we will just type the data type like string. Yes, if you want to type, you can just type dynamic to it as well, like it will work. But it's better if you know what kind of data you should get. Okay, so in that we have future dot delete. So what future dot delete does is like it just kind of a countdown or something, like it just shows you a kind of countdown, and after that particular countdown it will execute the entered code. So what it is, we said the time, the countdown is of 2 seconds, duration, then in duration we have seconds is equals to 2. Then the second argument, so these are two positional arguments. Second argument is a callback function. So call it, we have created a lambda function here. Okay, so in the lambda function we are returning large letter. So after 2 seconds this statement will be executed, and in order section we will have large letter. Okay, so what it will return, it will return your order is large letter, large let, sorry, and then it will going to print it directly. So this is how the future works. So I think you got a little bit idea of about the future, but when we are going to use it in Flutter, you will have better idea since we are limited to Dartpad website. I have not downloaded the SDK separately for compiling the Dart code, and I'm not showing you on my machine directly. So Dartpad is a bit limited with these things, but okay, we will cover this thing betterly in the Flutter series. Okay, so now we're going to talk about object oriented programming. So as I said before, like we are targeting to like minimize the things which we are going to cover in Dart. So I'm just covering very few things which any beginner like who doesn't have any experience with programming should have before continuing to Flutter. Okay, so this is what we are doing. Okay, so and again, while I'm going to work on the Flutter series, I will also explain everything and you will have a better idea over there. Okay, so also one more thing, I have provided the references in the comment section, so you can just go with those references. After this video, the next video will be around 1 to 2 days after this video. And till then, what you can do, I have provided the references, so you can go through those tutorials or documentations and you will have a better idea about this thing. Okay, so let's continue with object oriented programming. Okay, so first of all, in object oriented programming, the most important thing is classes. So what is classes? So this thing is common, what now I have to teach you for 5 minutes is common for all the object oriented programming languages, whether it's Java, whether it's C++ or any programming language which is object oriented. So the logic is same. So here you can see this picture which I got from the Google searches. So this is really interesting picture and I have written a blog about it. So consider the god want to create dogs. So the dogs would be of different breeds and have different properties. So to do that, what god does, god creates a class. Okay, so here's god creates a class. So this is the class. Okay, then god added some attributes to the class. So the name of the class is dog. Okay, so god created a class which is dog. Okay, and then they added god added some attributes to it, such as breed, size, age and color. So these are the attributes which god added to a class which named is dog. Okay, so after that, dog also added some behaviors. Okay, so we call them as behaviors, or in better terminology we call them as methods. Okay, which is similar for all dogs. Okay, but depending upon the attributes, it might change the output, but at last they have the same functionality. Okay, for example, examples of what the methods of a dog would be eat, sleep, sit, run, etc. So using this dog class, god create all types of dogs which we see today. Okay, therefore the object oriented programming is not a new thing which we are learning in this now. So it's really before our existence. It exists before our existence. Okay, so in this picture you can see this thing, this is the class, the dog class, which has attributes and some methods. Okay, so dog created god created this class, and then what god does, they created 3 different objects of this class. So this is in class, then god created 3 different objects. So in this image you can see these are 3 different objects from this class. Okay, so these objects have different attributes, different values of attributes. For example, breed of this is this, size is large, age is 5 years, and color is black. Similarly for all the other two. So this is how, by creating just one class, the god is able to create all different kinds of dogs which we see today. So this is how it works. Okay, so that's why the definition of class is basically, classes are blueprint for creating objects. So these are blueprints for creating objects. You can see these are the blueprints, because if we do with the traditional way of creating variables, then we will have a hell lot of variables and it could create problem with us. Okay, so this is how it works. So here I have just computed this image into code, and this is how it looks. So I have used enums. I think we have already covered the thing regarding enums enumeration in the last video. So I have used enums in here. So what I will do, I will just copy this code and explain you in the Dartpad website rather than this PDF. Okay, since we have not used Dartpad. Okay, I just copied it, paste and format. Okay, so there are some issues that's showing. Let's see. Okay, so the issues is basically with the inverted commas, the font difference is a bit, that's why we are getting this issue. Okay, so I'll just correct it. Similarly for all, like if we can just, okay, I'm limited with this again. So similarly, we will do this for all the inverted commas. Just a second. Okay, so now we are done, and we are having still one error, which is white is. Oh, okay. So this should be capitalized white. Okay. So I think now it's done. So I'm gonna just run this, and we should have something in the console section. So okay, so you can see it's running. So dog is eating, dog is running, and dog is sleeping. That's all we are doing in quarantine. Not we are learning something. So it's a really a good thing that we are doing something productive. So I really appreciate your dedication towards this thing. Okay, so let's get back to the topic. So what I did, like I have created three different enums. So first is breed. Breed has some kind of values, which is Neapolitan, Mastiff, okay, then Maltese, and then Chow Chow. After that, size, we have small, medium, and large, and then color, we have black, brown, and white, okay. So now we're going to go to the main method and see how it works. So first of all, what we did, like we created an object from the class. So this is how we create an object of the class. So at this point we declared like dog, my dog. So the dog is the name of the class, then my dog is the object of that class. Okay, so after that we need to call the constructor so that we can initialize it. We need to call the constructor so that we can initialize it. At this step, like I'll write comments so that you can have a better idea. We have declared the class object. Okay, then I will say in this statement we have called the constructor of the class with initial data. Then we have called the member of the class. Okay, so that's what we did. Okay, so going back here, so what we did is basically this is the class which we have created. So this is how we create a class. We specify the word class keyword here, then we add the class name. So prefer like first letter of the class should be capital, and like this is how we do. Okay, so after that we have curly braces, and in this section we have first created the attributes, as I said. So these are the attributes, and in the attributes you can see there's an underscore icon. So the underscore icon is basically the representation of underscore icon is basically the representation that this is a private thing. This is a private variable. So what private and public is, basically if you specify something as private, then it is limited to your class. Okay, so you cannot you access that out of that class. But if you have specified something as something as public, then for defining something as public, just in, remove that underscore icon before the name as we are doing this. Okay, so this way all the variables are now public. So when these are public, then we can access them using the period operator. So we will just get back to it in a second. Okay, then we have the constructor here. So this is the constructor. What constructor does is basically constructor creates the object. Constructor creates the object. Okay, so there are different types of constructors. They are named constructors and a lot of things. So we will cover those things in the series of Flutter. And there's also like extending a class and implements, interface, inheritance, and a lot of topics are still in the object oriented program. I have just teaching you at a very basic level of this thing, but while we are going to code apps in Flutter, I will cover those things. Okay, so this is how it works. This is the constructor in which we have just all the variables here, and then we have the methods. Okay, so we say eat, then in that we just print eat. Okay, so this is how it is. Okay, and then we are calling it. So you can see how to call or how to get a particular member of this class. So all these are also like we can call them as members of a class. Okay, so to access them we need to go through the object, like the my dog is an object of that class. Then we will specify the period operator, which is this dot, and then we will specify what we want to have it. Okay, have from it. Just the underscore from here as well. Okay, now what I do is do, let's say, print my dog dot size. Okay, so this is something which I am printing. Let's see what it shows. Okay, so it shows me null because they entered something from here. Okay, so I will correct this thing. So this is basically how we define classes, and this is basically what we call object oriented programming. So I have given you very basic idea about this thing. We will cover more about it, and I will just there's some error I think, or there's some problem, that's why we it shows null. I will correct it, and you will find that in the updated PDF in the description. Okay, from the link in the description. So this is there anything extra? Okay, so there is cascade operator. So what cascade operator is basically when we are using this thing like my dog dot eat, my dog dot run, my dog dot sleep, we can just specify two dots, which is the cascade operator, in the following way to do the same thing. Okay, this, so I think that's all for this video, as I want to cover this much thing in the Dart series. Like as I said in the first video of the series, like I want this video series to be this much that we can move to Flutter app development, and we can develop some apps in Flutter. So that's the purpose of the series, and I think now we can move with the Flutter app development series. We can continue start developing apps in Flutter, and you will have the app in your phone from the first video of the series. So you will enjoy a lot. Okay, so I have all the plan laid out for everything you want to learn in this Flutter series. So if you are at beginner level, you can at least reach to the intermediate level. Okay, so if you have any doubts or something you want to discuss, then you can just drop them in the comment section. Or if you want to like interact with me, or like if you have some personal doubts regarding any of the topic, and you have some suggestions to improve the conversation or either the course content, then you can just get to me using Twitter or LinkedIn, whatever you prefer. Okay, so there are some references which I have also referred to create this series, which is tutorials point and Dart docs. I would highly prefer you to go with the Dart docs, like whenever, as I said in my earlier videos, like whenever a new tech stack comes, they have their documentations. So documentations are the base or the root level thing from which you can learn anything, because everything else you will see is basically the interpretation or the filtered data from the documentation. So this is what I say. Okay, so go through these references, and but till the next video comes, you should have a good idea of all the things, and I would highly recommend just not to rely on this series of Dart programming which I have created these three videos. Just go through these references. These are like pretty much good, I think, and I've also read all of them, mostly all of them. So you can just go with them and have a better idea of Dart programming. Okay, So I think that's all for this video. Thanks for watching, and I surely catch you in my next video.